So far, what we have done in this topic of nuclear physics or understanding of nucleus of any atom. So whenever a nucleus form nucleons, which are neutron and proton, it achieves more stable state, it loses energy. And the loss of energy is equal to loss of mass energy, rest mass energy. Okay, so that's one key point. And how is that binding energy? So loss of energy in form of a loss of mass. Delta M is supposed loss of the mass. So delta M into C square is the loss of energy, and which becomes the binding energy. And then this is how we calculate binding energy. So binding energy is difference in original mass minus the combined form mass. And this is very simple. So this, it may look a little complicated, but it's extremely simple relationship. It's a difference in mass into C square. So any compound, and what we do here, even though we need a difference in mass of nucleus, by adding mass of electron, we convert into mass of an atom. This also becomes mass, atomic mass. This also becomes atomic mass. Or if, so atomic mass of hydrogen is known for any atom. If we know what the atomic mass is from the periodic table, we can calculate binding energy. And binding energy, from binding energy, one more thing which is even more relevant here is binding energy per nucleon. We divide this binding energy by mass number, we get the binding energy per nucleon, and this is the shape. That's what we discussed yesterday. And you know, as the mass number increases, it gradually increases. It reaches a maximum in this range, maximum is for Fe, and then start decreasing. And this particular shape is responsible for atomic energy. So before we go to atomic energy, we said all most of the heavy nucleus are unstable. What does unstable means? They change into relatively more stable form. And when the nucleus change, actually the element itself changes. So what is, so there are different ways it can decay or it can change form. The three ways are alpha decay, gamma, beta decay, and gamma decay. In case of gamma decay, there's no change in form. Element remains same. Well, gamma decay will come to last. So today we'll focus more on alpha decay and beta decay. What is alpha decay? Unstable nuclear emits an alpha particle. So very simple, easy to write that equation. So this is a nucleus here. We talk about nucleus. We add electron only for sake of convenience of calculation of mass. So this is the nucleus. If it decays alpha, it emits an alpha particle. And here in this case, what we do is a conservation of charge number and conservation of mass number. We can easily arrive at this. So very easily what we notice here in case of alpha decay, the atomic number decreases by 2 and mass number decreases by 4. And if we have to calculate a difference in energy, we calculate initial mass energy. We call it initial rest mass energy. The rest mass energy is mass into C square. Which mass? Mass of the nucleus. So how we calculate mass of the nucleus? Mass of the atom minus the mass of electron. And that's the initial mass energy. What is the final mass energy? We calculate mass of this nucleus, that is mass of the atom, minus the mass of orbiting electron. And same thing we repeat for particle also. So this also becomes mass of the atom minus mass of the electron. So this is initial mass energy, this is final mass energy. If energy decreases, means energy gets released. So here, and we call this release of energy is Q. So if this term is higher than this, there's a loss of mass energy, and that mass energy comes in form of, this gets released, and that's called Q value. Q value is a decrease in rest mass energy, which gets released in case of nuclear reaction. This UF, and we calculate the difference between the two. That's a loss of energy, which is Q value, and we get the mass of electron gets cancelled. So very simple terms. What is in case of alpha decay? What is the amount of energy gets released? Atomic, but this is something basically we're talking about atomic mass of this, minus atomic mass of this, minus atomic mass of this into C square. So we can directly, though we are concerned with nucleus, by adding electrons, we have converted into atomic mass, just for sake of convenience. So this is only 2 points, this is alpha decay. In case of alpha decay, this minus 4 minus 2, and this is the energy which is released in alpha decay. this is the energy released. And all these terms are very simple. This is mass of this, minus mass of this, minus mass of this, atomic masses. So let's understand this curve a little bit. This is a question given. This is very rough way they have drawn a curve, a hypothetical curve. So this is the binding energy per nucleon is given here. Mass number of nuclei is given. And this is how they're showing. And they have shown four different nuclei. Which are the four different? There's Z value, there's X, Y, Z and W. What is which process would release energy here? Let's look at one by one. Which is one process? Y can convert, it can split into two. Y has how many nucleons? It has 60 nucleons. And it may split into two Z, so each of 30. So will energy get released here is the question here. So if if energy gets released when the binding energy increases. In this particular case, binding energy will decrease. Here the binding energy decreases, hence energy will not get released. What is the condition for energy to get released? Increase in binding energy, similar to what happens in case of hydrogen atom. So there, this is a decrease, it will not get released. Second, we took like if W gets converted to X plus Z. What is W? 120. 120 can be as X plus Z is possible. So is the energy get released? Let's calculate. Is there increase in binding energy? So what is the binding energy of W? W of binding energy is equal to 120. So binding energy of a nucleus of W is equal to 120, number of nucleons, into binding energy per nucleon. That's the energy of W. And what is binding energy of product? Here X plus Z, X will be equal to binding energy per nucleon is 5. So that Z will be equal to 5 into 30. And third one is equal to BE. X plus Z. And where is the Z compound here? Okay, this is Z I have taken. And X also is 90. So if we take X, this is equal to 90 into 8. So what is the condition? If these sum of these two is greater than this, if greater, then energy will get released. Is it greater? We can check. So one by one, we can all three of them check. What you notice here, you can easily solve that question and you can actually calculate also Q value for each process. What is Q value for each process? Q value is for each process equal to initial mass energy minus final pass energy, or in terms of binding energy is equal to final binding energy minus initial binding energy. You can calculate each case, what is the Q value. Q value greater than zero indicates positive energy release, which is exothermic. And if it is negative, it means it is endothermic. What does endothermic means? In that case, to make that reaction happen, actually need to supply energy rather than energy getting released. So all four cases, you can actually calculate what the Q values are. And if it was multi-correct question, whichever comes positive, when the Q value comes positive, energy will get released. So in this case, there's what is the other reaction? Actually, you can easily do that question. That's a fairly easy question. And I think it's also a simple question, graph between two things. So which are the terms related, R, R naught and A? So what is the equation we have which are related term? R is equal to what? R is equal to R naught, A raised to power 1 by 3. So what is R by R naught equal to? R by R naught equal to A raised to power 1 by 3. Take log of both sides, we can easily get this equation. It comes as a straight line. Let's look at some more question. These are the things that what are and what are these denote the nuclear forces between proton and proton, between proton and neutron, and between neutron and neutron. So when we talk about nuclear forces, it is independent of charge. So the force is whether it's between proton and proton or between proton and neutron. In this all three cases, forces are equal if the distances are equal. So this question is just to indicate it is independent of charge, though it depends on spin. In this case, spin is neglected. We are assuming the spins are similar. Okay, now this slight difference here. Let's understand what is the difference between second question. Second question also, we have kept up neutron, proton, neutron, respectively. Separation is 1 femtometer. Very small separation. So one case is a proton, proton. Second case is proton and neutron. And third case is neutron and neutron. Here in this case, they are not talking about first of all, there would be two forces acting in this case. We are talking what is the difference between two question. We are neglecting gravitation force. Let me denote the magnitude of net force. See, in this case, two forces will act. Which are the two forces? Nuclear forces and electrostatic forces. Since it's proton-proton, the electrostatic forces will be repulsive in nature and nuclear forces will be attractive in nature. This is how the forces will act. So this is a nuclear force, this is electrostatic force. In this case, what will happen? No electric forces, electrostatic force will act. Because there's only one charge here. So what will happen in this case? Only nuclear forces will act, which is attractive in nature. And here also nuclear forces will act, which is attractive in nature. So what I notice, these two cohesive forces are equal. Here the magnitude of force is the smallest. So here FPP is lesser than FPN and FNN. And FPN and FNN are equal. That's the option. Okay, now next question. Two protons kept at a separation of 10 nanometer. And nuclear force and electrostatic forces. So if we keep them at certain separation, previous case, which was higher? Previous case, nuclear forces were higher. Now, if they are kept at a distance of 10 nanometer, and both are proton and proton, electrostatic force will be repulsive in nature. And there will be, how about nuclear forces? Nuclear forces are attractive. I draw nuclear forces here. Nuclear force will be attractive. Question is, among the two, which is much larger than the other? And this question highlights the fact that nuclear forces are short-range forces. Nuclear forces are acting only for distances of the order of few Fermi. Fermi is 10 to power minus 15, which is, this one is 10 to power minus 10. 10 into 10 to power minus 9, and then this. So this is much, much smaller than, this is much larger than Fermi. So this distance is much greater than Fermi distance. And at this distance, nuclear forces will be negligible. So when we can place them at a separation of say like one Fermi, which force dominates? Nuclear force dominates. And when it becomes something like 10 Fermi, what will happen? In that case, electrostatic force dominate. This becomes much smaller. Now we come to the question, why this question, in case of heavy nuclei, tend to have larger n by z ratio. Why is that so? See, what would have happened, let's compare a heavy nuclei and a small nuclei. So if you have if this is a small nuclei and this is a larger nuclei, what is the difference between the two? In case of this, all are small nuclei, all are at distance of order of what kind of distance? They are in the range of one Fermi to two Fermi. So all cases, what will happen in all nucleus when you take? Electrostatic forces are acting and nuclear forces are also acting. There are certain ratio and they are in state of balance. Now when it becomes large, if one force increases in greater proportion and other force increases in smaller proportion, then only the problem comes. Why is the problem coming in case of larger one? As it keeps growing in size, Fe increases and Fe increases with increase in number of protons. Increase in number of protons. All protons also, there's a proton here, there's a proton here. These two protons also will exert repulsive force. But what is happening? So here, and if we have proton, neutron here, there also they'll exert repulsive force. But when they're a short distance, attractive force also is acting. But when it's a large distance, only the repulsive force acting, attractive force becomes insignificant. And it is happening because of two reasons. What are two reasons? Let's try and understand here. So two reasons we have to understand and how this problem is solved by extra neutron. Extra neutron does two things. What are two things? What are two reasons why this condition arises? First of all, if I add neutron, it does not experience any repulsive force. So replacement of proton with neutron reduces repulsive force. Okay, so this is the condition which helps. And second thing, why this problem has, first of all, first case, why this problem has come? This problem has come because Coulomb force is a long range compared to nuclear force. Had they both had same range, similar condition what existed in a small nucleus, similar condition could have existed in a larger nucleus. If both were having similar relationship with distance. The relationship is dissimilar. That's why Fe is long range and Fn is long range. Fn is short range. Increase in size, this becomes extra, this becomes more destabilizing. So this is overcome by these two conditions. So both are correct option. This is multi-correct option. This is a very interesting question. And we keep hearing about black hole. Now, all of you would have heard of black hole. There's something in the light house will not escape. Now, force, the gravitational force of attraction becomes very small, very large. So neutron star also something similar. Let's try and understand. So if neutron star, we say black hole, it collapses to very small size. Why does it collapse to such a small size? Basically, it is composed only of nucleus material. So our orbital electrons collapse. It becomes, so if we have a neutron star, its density will be same as the density of nucleus. And we have calculated roughly the density of nucleus is of the order of 10 to power 17 kg per meter cube. So what this question is, just to understand significance of this density, let's try and understand what it means. So if a neutron has a density equal to that of nuclear matter, assume the star to be spherical, find the ratio of neutron star which has a mass equal to this. So this is the mass it has. What is the radius it will have if it has a density equal to density of nucleus? And this, what is this mass? To get understanding, say when you read 4 into 10 to 30, our mind doesn't register what this number. The only thing is too large a number. To give some significance to this mass is twice the mass of the sun. So what it means is, suppose sun, if the sun, if there is a sun which has twice the size of the sun in our solar system, if that sun were to convert into a neutron star, what would be its radius? How large that radius would be? And if we do this calculation, very simple, with this mass we divide by, we just, density into volume, and we equate it to mass, it comes about 15 kilometers. It becomes so small. And some of you, you can try and imagine if the mass become, radius becomes so small, what will happen to gravitational pull on the surface of such neutron star? Gravitational pull become gm by r square, r becoming so large, sun, it will be extremely, extremely heavy. So you can just imagine how strong it is. Just to give an idea what happens in case of black hole kind of thing, neutron star. Okay, coming back to alpha decay. Alpha decay, we briefly discuss few things. Alpha decay, this alpha decay, as it changes from here to here, it loses mass, delta m is lost, and delta m gets converted in form of q. That's what happens. So this mass is greater than this mass in case of alpha decay. So there's a decrease in mass, which gets converted in form of q value in release of energy. And in case of alpha decay, what are common terms which get conserved in case of normal physics or what you call Newtonian physics, same thing are valid even in case of alpha decay. Mass number is conserved, which I already talked. Charge number is conserved. Even momentum also is conserved. This side momentum, if we take this whole system, momentum is conserved. Angular momentum is conserved. In energy also is conserved. But when we talk about energy here, here we are talking only about nucleus. This is a nucleus, and actually electron will contribute not much to energy. So it is nucleus and atom, there's no great difference, but still we are focusing only on the nucleus, what is happening in the nuclear reaction. So when we conserve, when we take the rest mass energy, even mass also is taken in form of energy, then we both side energies are conserved. And by conservation of energy only, we get this Q term. So energy also is conserved, including rest mass energy. Mass also is converted in form of energy. So let's try and understand in terms of, if we look at conservation of momentum. If the momentum is conserved, we can treat each of these three as a particle. They, each one of them have a mass. So let's say this was the X atom here. And this X element had had a mass A into M. A is a mass number, and then we can roughly approximate mass of one nucleon. AM is the total mass. Initially it is at rest. What happens when alpha decay takes place? There's a release of energy also. So whenever they split into two, It's like explosion. When you split into two, let's say this alpha particle, which will have mass equal to 4 into m, mass of one nucleon, and this will be a minus 4 into m. Let's say this one has velocity v1 in other one direction. Of course, the other one will have velocity in the exactly opposite direction. The moment, net momentum has to remain zero. So if we conserve momentum, we can write this mass into velocity negative sign. If I am taking here, that this direction is positive. So these two momentums are momentum of this and this in terms of magnitude, they are equal. Or you can say the momentums are equal and opposite. And moment I say momentums are equal and opposite, it means velocities are in inverse proportion of mass. Velocities are inverse proportion of mass. The smaller mass will have greater velocity. So that that's the outcome. And we have discussed this point earlier. And just like a reiteration, because many of you tend to forget, and there's no harm in having some kind of quick revision. What will happen to energy? This is the energy which is released. And this energy, I have briefly mentioned here, this energy, there's no EM radiation. You know, there's no charge, it's EM radiation. See, actually for EM radiation, you need kind of oscillating charge. There's no EM radiation. Just understand that part. And so wherever this entire energy, where would it go? Entire energy goes in form of kinetic energy of elements which are part of the reaction. So this kinetic energy, whatever Q value indicates energy which is released in the nuclear reaction here, or nuclear process here, that energies get transferred in form of kinetic energy to this and this. And this kinetic energy also, the total Q energy released, it will be shared between kinetic energy of two particles here. Daughter nucleus and alpha particle. What is the ratio of Q1 and K2? Ratio of K1 K2 kinetic energy is equal to mass. I have cancelled 1 by 2. M into V1 square. Mass of the first particle into V1 square. And this mass M also cancelled. This is 2 square. And we know M1 V1 equal. So we're using this property. So ratio of kinetic energy is proportional to ratio of velocity. And ratio of velocity is inverse proportion of the mass. So this will be equal to the mass of the second particle divided by mass of the first particle, which will be 4 divided by A minus 4. Thus, the ratio kinetic energy will get shared. This is the total kinetic energy. So I have two equations between kinetic energy. I can find individual kinetic energy in terms of Q. Velocity and kinetic energy are in one inverse proportion of mass. What does it imply? The smaller this particle is, greater share of kinetic energy it carries. So if just to understand here, if mass M gets, it gets broken into two elements. Parts, M by 2, M by 2. What will happen in that case? Kinetic energy is shared equally. What happens? Mass get split into 1 to 99 ratio. So one of them is 1 by 100, other is 99 M by 100. So which mass? This mass is 99 times smaller. So which will happen? So this will compare to kinetic energy of this, this will carry 99 times more energy. So whenever a large mass or any, whenever a mass gets split into two parts, the one which is having a smaller mass fraction will carry more energy. And the smaller the ratio is, greater the share of energy it will carry. And that's the basic, I'm just explaining the same inverse proportion of mass. That's, if you just understand ratio, that's enough. So what would K1 be? From this I can easily calculate. K1 will be equal to 4 by A. So this is in proportion of 4 divided by total K, A into Q. And energy of alpha particle will be equal to A minus 4 by A into Q. Naturally, this is much higher proportion of energy. So in case of alpha decay, major part of energy released is in form of kinetic energy of alpha particle. Major part of energy released is in form of kinetic energy of alpha particle. And since there's nothing else to share, there's no EM radiation and all, since this, there's nothing else to share the energy, all alpha particle will have almost the same kinetic energy. So in case alpha decay, alpha particle, first point is all major portion of energy, which is Q value. So there's a loss of mass. The loss of mass is can get converted form of energy, and that energy major portion is shared by alpha particle. And all alpha particle, if numerous alpha particles are released here, almost all of them will have almost similar kinetic energy. Some cases we see some random cases come. Yes.
Sir, like we say, even angular momentum is conserved, right? So why don't we include rotational kinetic energy? Like it's possible, right?
Basically, okay, when they split also, will they start rotating? See here, but this is something a small mass. In case of kinetic theory of gases also, in case of monatomic gas, why we not taken rotational kinetic energy?
Like moment of inertia will be zero.
Basically, what will happen if it is a single particle, very small in size, its kinetic energy due to rotation will be negligible. Radius becomes too
Yes,
small.
sir.
So the same thing. So we can leave skip that part. Okay. So if you want to understand, yes, a similar logic what applies in case of kinetic theory of gases, similar logic applies here. Actually, the radius becomes even smaller here. So it is negligible. Okay. But is well, as a principle, is that also applicable? Yes, it is applicable. Now coming to second type of decay, beta decay. We briefly talked about beta decay yesterday. Let us continue further. What is beta decay? There are two types of beta decay. And if nothing else is mentioned, we assume beta decay to be beta minus decay. Beta decay, if nothing is said, again to repeat, beta decay, there are two types, beta minus and beta plus. But if nothing is mentioned, it is, we take it as a beta minus decay. So beta minus decay involves emission of an electron. From where? From the nucleus. And beta plus decay involves the reverse of this antiparticle of electron, which is called positron. And positron, we have mentioned earlier also, what is positron? Positron has same mass as electron, but it has same charge as electron, but opposite in sign. This is positive plus E charge. And let's look at more detail what happens in case of beta minus decay. Beta minus decay, one way of explaining is what happens in this case. Beta minus decay takes place where there is an excess neutron. Neutron in the nucleus gets converted in proton. So if you write this reaction, let's understand what happens here. So when first of all, neutron, what is the number indicate here? The lower number indicates charge on this particle, which is zero. Neutron has no charge. And the upper level value indicates here mass number. This mass number is one, number of neutron. If it gets converted, let's say neutron gets converted into proton, but this alone cannot happen. Okay, when it forms, when it gets converted into proton, here the charge number is one, and this is also one. So what I notice, this is zero, it has become one. So there has to be some other element which has had to be negative minus one, and it has to be zero here. So even without knowing also, we could have easily figured out using conservation of charge and conservation of mass number, there has to be one more particle, which particle is nothing but electron. So when neutron gets converted into proton, it has to emit an electron. And this electron goes out of the nucleus. So this electron is not an orbital electron. And just to differentiate, that's why this electron is called a beta particle. Beta particle is also electron, but it is generated, is created in the nucleus. And in addition to electron, there's something called antineutrino. Nothing more we need to know. Antineutrino is another particle. So one is electron. You will have in both cases one kind of anti or strange kind of particle. So here, along with the electron, is antineutrino. We indicate with new bar here. Antineutrino has zero rest mass. It is chargeless. It has a spin. And antineutrino is nothing much. It is a particle which has taken several decades to detect, because when they conducted several experiments, they found the energies were not matching. Whatever Q value calculated, energies were not matching, because the antineutrino, only thing I read somewhere, it has such great penetration power. If antineutrino, it is, suppose Earth is here, if antineutrino or antineutrino particle, if it is moving, it can pass through the entire Earth. So basically, it passes through means it doesn't interact with anything. It doesn't collide, it doesn't create any effect. It's become extremely difficult to detect. So antineutrino is a particle which is extremely difficult to detect. Only thing you can figure out was the reason being this. It doesn't interact. It can have extremely large penetration power. So something which goes, which just passes through. So if we keep a shield here, we'll not notice anything. So we'll think as if nothing is coming from here. It will just pass through even large mass also. More than that, we need not know. So this one is an electron, but it's called a beta particle. And we also sometimes use the sign like beta minus to differentiate from orbiting electron. Otherwise, once it is emitted, it has exactly the same properties electron. No difference between this electron and orbiting electron. This in terms of same thing can be written in terms of this notation also. So what is happening here? It increases by Z plus one, extra proton gets added here. A remains same here and plus E, and I could have written that this is minus one and zero also and neutron. No change in mass number, but atomic number increases by one. So in case of beta minus decay, atomic number increases by one. This increase of one in the atomic number, and this is easy to detect because this is minus, so this minus adds here, it becomes plus. So and let's come to what is the Q value. How do we calculate Q value? Q value is mass of nucleus of this and minus the mass of nucleus of this. But should we add this also as the mass of this? Is this a nucleus particle or not? Is this also, should I subtract this mass also or not? See, when we calculate difference in mass, we are calculating difference in mass of the nucleus particles. But when we calculate loss of mass here or change in mass here, we include this mass of this beta particle. Why we do include? Because this also is a part of nucleus. This also is committing. So when we calculate this, this minus this minus this. Okay, so what is initial less mass energy? Initial less mass energy is simple. This is something mass of the atom minus mass of electron. Final less mass energy is, this is mass of the atom. If I subtract mass of electron, this becomes the mass of nucleus of this element here. Plus we are adding with the, okay, and we are adding plus M. Because this ME, this mass of electron, is a part of the nucleus. It has come from the nucleus. So that is UF. So what is Q value? UI minus UF. And we calculate this as an L. So this is something easy. This one that gets cancelled. So here again we notice mass of electron gets perfectly cancelled out. And it comes into a very simple equation here. Beta decay also. What is Q value? Rest mass energy of this element minus the rest mass energy of this element, atomic mass. We can directly take atomic mass. The atomic mass difference into C square gives you release of energy in case of beta decay. And this is the explanation for it. And where does energy go? This energy also, again, there's no radiation here. This also in form of kinetic energy of product particles. But how many product particles are there in this? This also is a particle, this also a particle, and this is a kind of, this also is a, not a particle, this is kind of radiation here. This is a something very different, we don't know much, and we will not discuss much. This also carries, so energy is distributed between this, this, and this. These two are particles. Between the two, which will carry more energy? Will this carry more energy or this will carry more energy? As I already mentioned, the smaller the fraction is, greater the share of energy it will carry. And this mass is a lot smaller than this compound, this element here. Hence, almost entire kinetic energy is only in case of, this carries negligible energy. Because here mass is much, much, much larger compared to this. It's thousands of times larger compared to mass of other particle. So in this particular case, it is kinetic energy. This carries very small proportion of total energy released. So we can understand case of beta decay, kinetic energy generated on account of loss of rest mass energy is shared between beta particle and antineutrino. Is shared mostly between beta particle, antineutrino in varying proportion. Because here neutrino, we don't know that this carries away some energy, and its energy of neutrino may vary. Hence, energy of kinetic energy of beta particle also varies. So kinetic energy of Y is negligible, and kinetic energy of beta particle varies from zero to almost to entire Q value. When is Q value? When in particular some cases, so energy carried by antineutrino varies. Since this varies, this also varies, and this carries very small part of energy. So energy of beta particle from zero to Q value. Beta plus decay, reverse of the previous one. What is beta plus decay here? Proton gets converted into neutron. So when this is how we write proton. This is the charge number plus, and this is the mass number. It comes to neutron. This is zero. So this is zero. The one has to come here plus one. So we have to have another particle which has plus one charge, and mass number has to be zero. And this part is what? This part looks yes, and it has to charge equal to electron charge. And this part is what is this called? This is called positron. Positron is antiparticle of electron. What does antiparticle mean? When electron and positron collide with each other, they completely destroy each other. Entire mass gets converted in form of radiation energy. I will come to that little later, the last part. Okay. So it creates a, so previous case, it was electron and antineutrino. Now this one is positron and neutrino. There's no bar here, this is neutrino. And again, neutrino, this is a property. When would this happen? This kind of reaction is favored when there's excess proton. And previous one, when there was excess neutron. So positron, electron are antiparticle, annihilate each other on collision with entire mass converted into radiation. So this sums up in terms of elemental notation. This can be written like this. Since one proton is converted, so one proton becomes less. That's why it becomes equal to Z minus one, Z minus one. And this is the same thing written in different form. So no change in mass number, because if one nucleon is converted into other nucleon. So both alpha beta plus decay and beta minus decay, the mass number remains same. One case Z value increases by when neutron converts into proton, it increases by one. When proton converts into neutron, it decreases by one. So here no change mass number, but atomic number decreases by one. Initial less mass energy. What is initial less mass energy? Is the mass of this atom minus the mass of electron. Mass of the atom, atomic mass minus mass of the electron. And here again, as we do in previous case also, this also is a part of the nucleus. I have to include this also in my system. So let's look at final mass energy, initial less mass energy. So what is the mass of the nucleus of this? Mass of the nucleus is atomic mass minus Z minus plus Z minus one electron. So M into Z minus one mass of electron. This becomes mass of this particle. Why we added plus ME here? This is this particle also. This is plus ME. Okay. In this case, you notice, unlike previous cases, when we take Q value, which is UI minus UF, when I subtract from here, this side has how many mass electron? This side has Z into ME. Let's see how many here equals minus Z ME. Plus 2 ME here. They both get added up. So when I subtract from here to here, this gets cancelled and we end up with minus 2 ME here. So that's one case, beta plus decay alone, where Q value is not atomic mass this minus atomic mass this. It is atomic mass this, minus 2 mass of electron. And the reason comes from here. We have done nothing new. We have just taken the mass of nucleus. And the reason why I use a beta name, because this electron or this positron here is nothing but part of the nucleus. It has come from the nucleus, so it has to be added as nucleus masses. Here also same thing is.
So in this case, can we calculate the Q value in terms of binding energy, like we have an extra particle, right?
See, Q value, okay. First of all, Q value can be taken in case of binding energy.
So like in alpha decay, we used increase in binding energy, right?
Alpha decay, did I use binding energy? See, binding energy, when we talk about binding energy, how do we get binding energy? See, alpha, how do we get binding energy? Tell me, suppose we calculate difference in binding energy. See, can I calculate binding energy of this element here? Is it difficult to calculate binding energy? No?
No.
Can we calculate binding energy with this also?
Yes, sir.
We can calculate. So what you have done is calculation of rest mass energy difference. Is it any different from binding energy? Actually, binding energy also do something, it will come in the similar form. It will come reverse the same thing. Now, how do you get binding energy? How do we get binding energy? And okay, maybe I'll just show one case, but it comes to the same thing. Binding energy also, if it is given, we can it'll come to this point again later. Okay, so this is on the first. Are you clear why, where from this has come?
Yes, sir.
So what we understood very briefly, in case of alpha decay, what is the Q value? Rest mass energy of this minus rest mass energy. Sorry. We take atomic mass of this minus atomic mass of this into C square. Beta minus decay also, this atomic mass of this minus atomic mass of this into C square. Only in case of beta plus decay, it is the atomic mass of this minus atomic mass of this minus 2 mass of electron into C square. And how is the energy shared in all three cases? In case of alpha decay, the energy is shared between this particle and alpha particle, because their mass proportion difference, mass proportion is not too large. But in case of, can someone tell me, there also we have written Y in case of alpha decay. I have written this, this is nothing but a daughter nucleus. Yeah, you will have something like this in alpha decay, beta minus decay, beta plus decay. And we mentioned in case of beta minus and beta plus decay only, we said this will have negligible kinetic energy. Why did we not say it will have negligible kinetic energy in case of alpha decay? We said Y will have negligible kinetic energy in case of beta minus and beta plus decay. I didn't say so in case of alpha decay. Why is that so?
Because alpha particle is considerable mass.
Alpha particle, what happens? What is the other particle there? Other particle, alpha particle has mass equal to 4 into mass of proton kind of thing. What is the mass the other particle has here? It is thousands of times lower. And is smaller the other particle is, greater the share of energy it will carry. So in case of alpha decay, out of the two particles, both have mass numbers. In this decay here, the other particle has mass of electron, much smaller. Hence, it carries even higher proportion of total kinetic energy. Is that clear? Okay. So now coming to one more thing related to this, sometimes this question also asked. Can someone ask, just read this statement, if we have isolated proton, nothing else, the proton exists. It doesn't, within nucleus it is happening, the proton is getting converted into neutron plus, proton in neutron plus positron. But if can isolated proton decay into neutron and positron? It does not happen. Whereas this happens. If there's an isolated neutron, it decays into proton plus electron. Why this doesn't happen? Why this happens? Can anyone think of a reason why this doesn't happen and this happens?
Maybe positron is not a very stable particle.
No, not that. Something else. Now, see, this one does not happen. Proton to neutron conversion does not happen. Decay does not happen. Neutron to proton conversion happens. Can anyone think of a reason why it happens? And answer is pretty simple only. Which will happen spontaneously? Whenever there's a release in energy. Which case the energy will get released? Wherever the mass becomes smaller. In this case, what is happening compared to proton, mass of neutron is greater. Mass has to increase. It means it has to receive energy. Here, neutron is getting converted into proton, a lower mass. So which reaction is favored? Where mass gets reduced, energy gets released, it reaches more stable state. Is this understood? Between neutron and proton, which has larger mass? Neutron. So when neutron gets converted to proton, its mass is getting reduced. So which kind of reaction are kept favored where energy is released? And how would energy get released when only mass gets reduced? So that's why the reason this is possible, this one is not possible. The value has to be positive. Okay, let's look at in case of alpha and beta decay. Sometimes many cases what happens? There may be successive decay. If heavy particle, it may have alpha decay, followed by beta decay, alpha decay, beta decay, it may happen. Successive decay. Suppose I have number of decay and there's some element here or some nucleus. It has, due to several nuclear processes, several nuclear decay, it has become like this. Can we find out how many alpha decay has taken place? How many beta minus or beta plus decay have taken place for it to reach from this state to this state? So what can we find out number of alpha and beta emissions in successive radioactivity? Can we find out? Can anyone think of? Because you have done it in chemistry also, and this very simple thing. How many can recall? How many alpha decay and how do we figure it out? See, what happens in case of beta decay? There's some difference, major difference between alpha decay and beta decay. In case of whether it's beta minus or beta plus decay, A value does not change. Because in case of beta decay, one nucleon is changing to other nucleon. So the number of nucleons are not changing. The number of nucleons are not changing in case of beta decay. So if at all there's any change in number of mass number, it can only be because of alpha decay. So A has become A minus 16. This has happened only because of alpha decay. Beta decay has no role in change of A value. So how many alpha decay? Each alpha decay reduces by 4. Here reduction in mass number is 16. It means how many alpha decay? 4 alpha decay has taken place. Shravani, have you understood this?
Yes, sir.
Can you tell me what you have understood? Are you clear? Why? Okay, tell me what you have understood. Can you tell me something what you understood? Suppose you have to explain me. Can you tell me based on this, how many alpha decay has taken place? How would you explain? Yes. Ramani?
Yes, sir. I'm here.
Thinking?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thinking. Okay. Oh, you know, see, this is something you can, computer also sometimes keeps going, thinking. So you are into this, going into circle. Okay. Anybody else would like to tell how many alpha decay, how do you figure it out? Shall we tell me, in case of beta plus decay and beta minus, what happens in case of beta plus decay? There are two numbers here. What are these numbers? There are two numbers here. One is mass number, another is atomic number. Okay. So in case of beta minus or beta plus decay, do both of them change? Only one of them will change? In case of beta plus or beta minus decay, both atomic number as well as mass number change, or only one of them change?
Both will
change. So it's going fast, even as well, going circle only. Okay. What happens in case of beta decay? Beta decay, either neutron gets converted into proton. So is there any change in number? What is nucleon means? What is this term A mean? A is equal to sum of proton and number of proton and number of neutrons. If one converts into other, will this total change here?
No.
Okay. So what we understand in case of beta decay, depending on this plus or decay or minus decay, neutron gets converted into proton or proton gets converted into neutron. So what will happen? So one number will decrease, other will increase. The sum of neutron and proton will not change. Mass number does not change in case of beta plus or beta minus decay. Shreya?
Yes, sir.
Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
So, can you tell me how many alpha decay will take place here?
4.
Why 4? Because can we ignore? So, see, first, have you understood logic? Whenever something happens, first we look at, has the mass number changed? If the mass number has changed, alpha decays must have taken place. How many alpha decays here? Each alpha decay will reduce the mass number by 4. Since it has reduced by 14, it is equal to 4 alpha decay. You can write an equation, but I don't believe this is something too cumbersome method to solve. 4 alpha decay has taken place. Is that easy to identify? So if 4 alpha decay has taken place, what would happen? First, we look at alpha decay. This can easily be identified from the mass number, as other decays do not change the mass number. And from here, you can identify 4 alpha decay. So one is 4 alpha. If 4 alpha decay takes place, A has become A minus 16. But how would atomic number change if 4 alpha decay takes place? Each alpha decay decreases by 2. It would become Z minus 8 or Z minus 8. So here, that's what the result of 4 alpha decay is, which is matching with the final product. It means there's no beta minus or beta plus decay, only 4 alpha decay. Shravani, is this understood?
Yes.
Last part also?
Yes, sir.
Are you thinking hard or are you going like this or like this? You understand what does this mean?
I'm clear, sir.
I'm clear, okay. Now again the question comes to you. Okay. Next case. Okay, next case we take this one. Suppose we take next case here. This case is like this. This is the decay. Can you identify how many alpha decay, how many beta decays? Sharmi, can you tell me how many alpha decay here and how many beta decay? Sharmi?
Two.
Two decay?
Yes, sir.
Only two, you see? Okay. Why two here? What has happened to, see, how do we identify alpha decay? How do we identify alpha decay? What is the result of alpha decay? How does alpha decay affect A value and Z value? How does alpha decay affect mass number and atomic number? It reduces, each alpha decay reduces by 4. Here addition is 12. It means 3 alpha decays. And when 3 alpha decay, this also it reduces Z by 6. Okay, each alpha decay reduces A by 4 and reduces Z by 2. Because alpha particle is something like this. So when this is emitted, there's reduction of 2 in the atomic number, the reduction of 4 in the mass number. So in this case also, if I look at this, Karthike?
Yes, sir.
Are you clear?
Yes, sir.
How many alpha decay?
Three alpha decays.
Three alpha decay. So if 3 alpha decay takes place, suppose I have a compound which is like this. And I write here, there are 3 alpha decays. Now, so 3 alpha decay will mean 3 into, this is 3 alpha decay. What is the compound I will get here? What is the value of my mass number? What will be the atomic number? What will be the atomic number and mass number of Y daughter nucleus?
Z minus 6 will be the atomic number.
Very good. Z minus 6 will be atomic number. How about
mass number? A minus 12.
A minus 12, which are done. Okay. So if a 3 alpha decay, so if, but I'll get Z minus 6. But here it is Z minus 8. What does it mean?
So two beta plus decays.
Okay, some beta decay also must have taken place. Does it clarify?
Yes, sir.
What is this? First, we identify 3 alpha. 3 alpha decay would lead to A minus 12 into Z minus 6 into this compound. So it decreases atomic number from. So there has to be some more beta decay. What is the result of beta decay? Beta decay is further reducing your atomic number. Beta decay is from here to here, it is beta decay. So let me, if I write something that. So what is beta decay doing here? Beta decay is further reducing your atomic number by 2. Which kind of beta decay reduces your atomic number?
Beta minus.
Beta minus. Beta minus decay reduces or beta plus decay reduces?
Oh, sorry, beta plus decay.
Beta plus decay. So just you read, because I have written like this, you said, if they want some people to look at this, is it beta minus or beta plus? Can you give me the reason also?
Yes,
what happens in case of beta plus decay?
Neutron gets converted to proton.
Okay. Beta plus decay. What gets converted into what? How should I think? I should think beta plus decay. What is being generated here? Electron or a positron? Beta plus means what?
Positron.
Positron. So this charge is positive. It means the other charge has to be, this is positive. And is this possible then?
No, sir.
No. So what has to be possible? If this is positive, there has to be proton on the left-hand side. So beta plus decay, proton leads to neutron plus A plus. And what is beta minus decay? I'm just trying to paraphrase. So beta minus means what? Electron is being generated. Neutron can lead to proton plus electron. That is beta minus decay. Are you easy to understand now?
Yes, sir.
So is it to memorize, or do you have understood? Can you easily identify when, what is beta decay and what is beta minus decay?
Yes, sir.
Preetam? Nishita? Oh, there's quite a few people are missing today. Okay, Kathy, are you following what is beta plus beta minus? Kathy Asubha, okay. Who else was? Anvita?
Yes, sir.
Are you clear what is beta plus and beta minus?
Yes, sir.
Tell me how would you tell logically, how would tell what is beta plus decay?
So like in the second example where A12 and Z8 is given, if the Z doesn't remain the same, then we can say that there's a beta decay.
Okay. And beta, what is beta plus decay? How should you understand beta plus decay? What does beta plus decay mean? And can I identify based on the logic, beta plus decay, is it neutron to proton conversion or proton to neutron conversion? Is that something I need to memorize? Or can I, in terms of simple logic, I can figure out beta plus decay involves what to what conversion? What is beta? What does the right hand side? What does beta plus? What is this word indicate? What does it generate? It generates an electron or positron? Beta plus.
Positron, sir.
It generates a positron. So if this is a positive charge, here also left hand side also has to be positive charge. Beta plus decay is proton to neutron conversion. Is that something you need to memorize or easily you can write? How do I write beta plus? Beta plus mentally, I think beta plus decay will lead to positron generation, outgoing positron. Where from this positive charge will come? It will come from the proton. So proton emits a positron, and since it is a positive charge is lost, it becomes a neutron. So beta plus decay will lead to decrease in Z. It has become one proton less. And this indicates number of protons. So beta plus decay will have decrease in this value, and beta minus decay will have increase in Z value. Okay, so in this case here, is that so from here we get Z minus 6, but final is Z minus 8. It means there is further reduction of atomic number by 2. How would atomic number reduction will take place? Proton getting converted into neutron. So number of which decay, there has to be 2 beta positive decay. Okay, similarly, can we identify what are the decays here? Next question. How many alpha decay and how many beta plus or minus decay? All of you try to do that. Dhanshree, you have identified or you have doubt?
I have identified, sir.
Tell me what is your, what is it, how many alpha and beta particle will be emitted in this case? Tell me.
Sir, there are 5 alpha decays and...
There's 5 alpha. Why 5? First, we look at what? Are you looking at Z first or looking at A first?
I'm looking at A first,
sir. No, the first thing is start with this. And what I notice here, there's a reduction of 20 in the mass number. So what does it indicate? It indicates how many alpha particles?
4, sir.
How many? Five alpha particles. So first thing, and there has to be 5 alpha decay. So if it is compound with something like this, if 5 alpha decay takes place, it will become some new compound which will have Z minus 10, A minus 20. But final value is not Z minus 10, is Z minus 6.
Yes.
It means there has to be some other decay also before it comes to this compound here.
Yes,
so
sir,
what has to happen in addition to 5 alpha decay? Here, well, is the Z value in this process increasing or decreasing?
It's increasing, sir.
Increasing. Yeah, it is increasing by how much? By 4.
By
so there has to be 4 more beta plus or beta minus. What is
beta
happening?
Beta minus.
Neutron is getting converted into proton. And when neutron gets converted into proton, there will be electron emission beta minus decay. How many? 4 beta minus decay. I hope all are clear. Pranam?
Yes, sir.
Are you clear about this?
Yes, I am clear.
They are pretty simple steps. Adwain?
Yes, sir.
So I think you do a couple of times. This is a very simple step. Nothing very complicated. You can easily do that. So I'll stop here and I will continue from here onwards. So we'll do some more numericals on what you have done so far in the next session. Today, what time we have our session?
They said there are no work sessions.
Yes, sir.
They said no.